Maharaj, there is a question from Priyananandidi. Why self-forgetfulness is beautiful?
The first book that we made for Srila Sridhar Maharaj was based upon this saying of his, reality the beautiful. And he, Guru Maharaj always gives tribute. He's not a plagiarist. If he is repurposing something from another, he'll mention who that person is. Some of his, like, everywhere sent the infinite, it's everywhere center, nowhere circumference. Most likely comes from Pascal, but was appreciated by Vedantists and others. But again, Guru Maharaj is always bringing everything in connection with Krishna conception. Just as when Nimai Pandit returned from Gaya, we know he was up to this point a grammar teacher for the primary students. The nature of a Prakriti Lila is the Lord's relishing that his position is clandestine or concealed, not obvious. Who was a cowherd boy as Krishna in the middle of Varnashram, right? Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Vaishya, Krishi, Go, Raksha, Vanijam, Vaishya, Karma, Svabhavajam. Here, he is saying, because of his pious activities as a cowherd in former lives, he became a Brahmin in this life. He did a lot of cow seva, go seva. And and as a teacher, then you would think, oh, he's the omniscient Supreme Lord, so he must be teaching the most advanced type of instruction to the most advanced student. No, he's teaching the basics of grammar to the primary students. He's concealed in that way. But upon his return, with the initial approval of his own guru teacher there within Sanskrit language and grammar, Gangadas Pandit, he begins teaching the students that everything indicates Krishna. That even, you know, the verbs are his shaktis. When he comes back from Gaya, as we told the other day on Srivas Thakur's appearance day, that when Srivas Thakur saw him in Navadvip, he's, you know, just burst out laughing. And Mahaprabhu said to him, when he say, like Chira Jeevi Hao, like, may you live forever. When that's when Srivastava, when are you going to give up all of this arrogant scholarship and studies, and if we understand that Srivas Thakur is Narada and he's playing a particular role in these pastimes, it's as if he is pressing him to begin in earnest the Nam Sankirtan movement, as it were. So on the one, it appears a little bit like chastisement. When are you going to give up all of this? But we always, all these, the Vaishnavas are saying that. Jnane priyasa mudapasana mante eva. Brahma is saying it. When are you going to give up all of this? Vidya kule ki kori vetar, Narottam says. When are you going to give it up? Guru Maharaj said to one like PhD candidate scholar type from Switzerland, he said, are you ready to admit that knowledge is poison? And there was a silence. And Guru Maharaj said, huh, not yet. Guru Maharaj himself said, in considering his Ramendra Sundar Bhattacharya, he's a Bhattacharya Brahmin. Means, you know, knowledgeable to the extreme, qualified to teach, that when he came to Gaudiya Math, and Saraswati Thakur was always hammering, you know, Jnana Shunya Bhakti. In the beginning, Guru Maharaj, it was like, you know, striking his heart, Jnana Shunya Bhakti, knowledge-free devotion, free from the need to know. Curiosity killed the cat. Right. I don't know if it killed Schrodinger's cat, but a lack of curiosity in that. No. Well, we're not curiosity or not curious. Same result. So the cowherd men, when they witness all these miraculous pastimes of Gopal, their talk amongst themselves of his either being a god, a devata, or God himself. And they're sharing their observations. They come as a group to Nanda Maharaj. And Nanda Maharaj said, no, the Garga Rishi told, he's a very pious lad, you know, in his previous life and this life, some Vishnu-like, very much like Vishnu. Like same, but different. That's an understatement. He's Krishna. So many Vishnu expansions he has. After Balaram, the Mool Sankarshan, the Chaturvyuha, the second Chaturvyuha, the Purusha avatars, Guna avatars, Leela avatars, Yuga avatars, Manvantara avatars, Shaktivesh avatars of all variety. Like Vishnu, and I must have done something pious to have a son like this, but I assure you, nothing to see here, nothing out of the ordinary. And they're saying, yeah, because Gopal, he's so dependent on our love and affection. Because he is Bhakta Vatsala. Everything they say is true, meaningful in different ways. And they say, also, he talks so much nonsense. That could be God himself. As Indra thought, this child is precocious, and he, with his nonsense talking, has convinced these, you know, Jnana Shunya cowherd men to give up worshiping me and to take all the paraphernalia from my puja and offer it to Govardhan Hill. And he says that one, that like, I forget the word used, but like, vacha, abala, like, oh, like, yeah, means talkative. So, so Guru Maharaj, he would say that he repurposed this line from some French thinker or someone of French descent. Reality the beautiful. Oh, and what I was telling you, how Mahaprabhu, he's telling his students of, oh, Srivast Thakur saying, so when are you going to give up all this scholarship and, you know, become a devotee? So they're preaching to him, trying to convert him to Krishna consciousness. He's already Krishna, but Krishna consciousness is another thing. It's the property of the devotees, and particularly Srimati Radharani. And so Srivast Thakur is pressing him, and Mahaprabhu is saying, as we understand to this day, he's saying happily that, well, you're a devotee of Krishna, and by your well wishes, certainly that will happen. Even in the case of Mahaprabhu, the case of Krishna, if it is the will of the devotees, then it must happen. As Srila Gurudev told around the time of the installation of the deities in Koikali, his name, Radha Raman Sundarju, is that the name? Pardon me? Anyway, at that time, and he said, the will of the Vaishnava is supreme. As Krishna says in the Gita, Kaunteya prati janihi name bhakta pranasyati. The observation is made that Krishna is telling Arjuna to declare this. Because, you say, well, why not just say it directly himself? Because he said he wouldn't take up arms in the Kurukshetra battle, which he found a workaround. He took a chariot wheel from the broken chariot and was going to kill Bhishma Dev with that, like a giant chakra. And Yeyatamam Prabhadyante Tamstateva Bhajamyaham. He also promised in Bhagavad Gita, as you surrender to me, I will reciprocate that. So it means love and affection toward Krishna, and then from Krishna, love and affection toward the devotee. What a wonderful thing, actually, inconceivable, that the original Supreme Personality of Godhead, Swayam Bhagavan, can have a personal, loving relationship with someone who, I mean, a relationship is based on both sides loving one another, but that that's possible with divinity has never been fully, properly conceived and fully expressed, as is in Krishna conception. Shanta Dasya Sakya Vatsalya Madhura. All the possibility, the full spectral range of loving relationship is possible with Krishna. But that's Krishna's promise. But then we find in the Bhagavatam, in the Naparayam Sloka, Niravaja Samyutam, that Krishna's telling the Braja-gopis, the sort of love and devotion you have in your hearts, I cannot reciprocate. I promised in the, now I have to break my, I can't. It's too great, it's too pure. Let virtue be its own reward. I can't reciprocate what is in your heart. Even my giving myself to you, it's not enough. So, Guru Maharaj says, Saraswati Thakur corroborates in the Chaitanya Bhagavat purport that he becomes their canvasser to feeling himself unable to properly reciprocate the love and devotion of Radharani and Braja-gopis. He descends in the world as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Jadi Gaurana Hoita Tabiki Hoita Kamari Daritam Dehe Radhar Mahima Prema Rasa Simo Jagata Janatake. To tell everyone how great they are, Radharani and the Braja-gopis. Sureshanam Durgam Gati Ati Shayano Panishadam Muninam Sarva Durima Vinyasya Premno Nikila Pashu Palambujadrisham Sachaitanya Kame Punaravidashor Yashati Vadam. The Chaitanyastakam also. Sureshanam Durgam. Rarely, whether it's the Devatas, the Upanishads, the Vedas, even Brahma and Shiva, we're told they're hankering for an opportunity, a glimpse. Narada, Sukha, they're hankering for a glimpse, a drop of that divine substance. And now Krishna himself, he's descended as Gauranga Mahaprabhu, and he's become the canvasser of Radharani and the Braja-gopis. Radhar Mahima, expressing her greatness, Prema Rasasima. What is the heights of Krishna Prem, particularly Mahabhav, which is the exclusive possession of Srimati Radharani. And that Nimai Pandit came back from Gaya, he is saying, you know, where is Krishna? Just like after he took sannyas, Kahan Krishna, Prananath Murali Badan, Kahan Karam, Kahan Pan, Brajendra Nandan. He's asking all the time, where is Krishna? His heart is being flooded with Krishna Prem. Saying that it looks like the Ganga has avatared from his eyes. The avatar of the Ganga is coming out of his eyes in tears, moistening all the ground. And he's repeatedly crying, falling to the ground in ecstasy. And now all the devotees, Gadadhar Pandit Srivastava, they're all surrounding him. They're falling to the ground in ecstasy, sometimes on top of one another. And what does it say? Which goddess? Maybe Janavi, that is smiling, seeing this beautiful scene. The Nimai Pandit, Gadadhar, they're all crying incessantly and fainting in ecstasy upon one another. Oh. So Nimai Pandit, he begins explaining, now he's returned, he still has his students, but now he's saying, everything indicates Krishna. Everything. Just as Guru Maharaj mentions in this regard, Madhvacharja. Saying the local context of any word. Contexts are like reins, a bridle, reins on a horse that allows you to steer it in a particular direction. Nimai Pandit is telling his students, if you steer any word in a direction other than Krishna, it's illusion. It's deceptive. Everything can be traced back to Krishna. Every sort of expression that is possible, we can trace back to Krishna conception. And Madhva says, if you take the bridle and the reins off the horse, then the horse runs according to its own necessity. So if you remove the local context of any word, any concept, then it will run in the direction of Krishna, Krishna conception. So, remember, Nimai Pandit, he's descended to introduce Nam Sankirtan. So then, naturally, he will show everything goes back to Nam, right? Hari Nam, the Nam of Hari or Krishna. So, Srila Guru Maharaj, he's repurposing these statements, aphorisms like Hegel, you know, die to live, reality is for itself and by itself, right? self-determination. These are Hegelian expressions, Guru Maharaj connecting them all to Krishna conception. So when this philosopher uses phrase, reality, the beautiful, Guru Maharaj liked this very much. So because it's like satyam shivam sundaram. This is satchit anandam, the ultimate expression of the truth is in anandam, joy, happiness, ecstasy. So here, satyam, truth, auspiciousness, shivam, sundaram, beauty. Then if you put them together, sundar ananda, ananda sundar. Krishna is beauty and ecstasy personified. He is happiness, ecstasy, rasaraj, akhila rasamrita murti. He's the rasa amrita. Murti, and he's reality, the beautiful. The ultimate reality is beautiful. Then Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavan. Brahma, all accommodating. Paramatma, all permeating. Within one, everything is within that. The other one, it is within everything. All accommodating, all permeating, then what is the hallmark of Bhagavan? All attractive, drawing everything to the center. How? Like magnetism. We know in the world there's different types of magnetism. What is one that you hear most about with regard to people and beautiful people is charisma. Right? It's a type of magnetism. People are drawn to them. So what to speak of Krishna? Right? Kandarpa koti kamaniya vishesha shobham. Yam shama sundaram achintya guna swarupam. But what did I say? So he is inconceivably beautiful, charming, and sweet, and everyone is being drawn towards this central conception of the infinite. So reality and its ultimate expression is beautiful, ecstatic, full of love and joy. So when we speak about, if someone says, why is self-forgetfulness, and we're assuming this means as applied to Krishna conception, beautiful, then the answer is obvious, because so means forgetful of one's, not factoring in one's own, forgetful in this sense, not factoring in one's own imposition or how do I say, expectation for a particular outcome. So self-forgetful, that's being the personality is so beautiful, charming, and sweet, and loving, and affectionate, that that doesn't become a consideration. So, and consideration of Krishna's position as reality, the beautiful, then self-forgetfulness applied in connection with Krishna conception must translate into beauty. You understand? And so, in the how beautiful and seductively charming is Krishna, expressed in the Brahma Sangita, Kandarpa Koti Kamaniya Vishesha Shobham. Remember, Shobha, like Shobana, Krishna, Shobana, Shobha means beauty. Kandarpa Koti Kamaniya. Saying like the attractiveness of 10 million cupids personified as one. Because this not only tells us something about beauty, but why use cupid? Because we're talking about attraction here, or magnetism in this meaning. Just like there's gravity in the general sense, it's holding everything together and drawing everything towards the center. But here, this sort of magnetism is not beauty in a passive sense, but so compelling that you want to offer yourself to them in service. You know, bhajaniya sarva sadguna vishishta, Bhagawan proper means this. That whose qualities, who is so qualified as to compel one, you know, voluntarily to offer themselves automatically in response to that beauty. And just simple examples I've seen in this world, like that's you know, like a happy example or simple understanding. Sometimes adults, they see some very cute child. Maybe they never even met them. All of a sudden they encounter some really cute child. And automatically they want to give themselves to that child. It's an automatic reaction. They want to do something for them. They're willing to offer themselves in service to the child. They find them so charming. So we see that things, and also older, the men, women, people are enamored, but the example of the child is more safe. So if we can understand that how charming someone can be in this world, and compelling, the charm is compelling. One can't remain passive. They feel they must do something. Right? Then what we hold here, to go to the non-safe, Cupid, can only be talked about in a general way, but that's the greatest power of charm and attraction in this world, beyond just cute. And as Freud observes, he's saying, oh, this is actually the driving principle of material existence. And in this regard, he's an extremist. He's saying it's the reason for everything. And if something doesn't appear to be caused by this or the pursuit of this, its outcome, then it's just this very thing being repressed. That's his position. It's an extreme one. So he will say, you say, well, this artist drew this beautiful picture here. Are you saying that this is the driving principle behind that? And he will say, yes. It's repressed erotic tendencies being expressed in this way, but it's all based upon the erotic principle. So in one sense, we agree with him. As Srila Saraswati Thakur, Professor Sanyal, under his direction, presented this one booklet. It had a very interesting title, an arresting title. It's called The Erotic Principle and Unalloyed Devotion. So as you can imagine, that caught a lot of people's attention. What? They'd see this pamphlet. Erotic Principle and Unalloyed Devotion. They're thinking, maybe I should read this alone. But then you'll see, and actually it deals with this. Saraswati Thakur says that very beautifully, whether it's him directly or Sanyal under the influence of his thought, quoting him, he says that you cannot eliminate the erotic tendency, the erotic principle. He said, any more than you can eliminate existence itself. It's not like there's a type of existence where this is not a part of it. Right. So Freud tried to trace that even in the early stages of, children. And I don't want to get into that. It gets kind of gross. But the principle is there, and the seed of that principle. And as I thought, when we hear, as I think a little while ago, was that the cicada making that?
Yes.
Yeah. And then the tuke and so many things here. It's that principle operating, maybe in a very primitive way, instinctual, primitive, but it's there. That even tells you something. How inescapable it is. Right? That it's in every aspect of life, like Gurudev once was saying, and not, teasing, or he said, the children, they can be taught about reproduction through the Brahma Sangita, the first slokas there. It's saying, the translators are saying, if we can't express this in any other words than Shambhu Shiva and Maya and how the jivas are impregnated into the womb. This is how this works. So everywhere you see this principle, Freud, he's not what you would generally conceive of as a theist. But still, he was overwhelmed in identifying this and seeing traces of this and everything. Reminiscent of, what is that song? Narayanam. Shanti Paramartina Jagadanam Mayam Lubdha Kamini Kamugam Mayam Narayanam Mayam Dira Pashanti Paramartina. The slogan says, according to what your core consciousness is, that's how you see the world. So a businessman sees everything as a business opportunity. It says, and someone filled with lust, they see, they're seeing everything is being scrutinized in that way. And then it says, and also, the devotee is seeing everything through devotional eyes. Premanjana charita bhakti vilochanena. Santaksa deva hridayeshu vilokayanti. Yam shama sundaram. There's the word sundaram. Yam shama sundaram achintya guna sarupam. The inconceivable beauty of Krishna. They're seeing it everywhere and everything. So Saraswati Thakur, He's making the point. This principle, this erotic principle, can it be expressed in unalloyed devotion in that plane? It's something we can't discuss in a cavalier way or in detail, but the premise of the Krishna consciousness movement, its contention is yes. And as he told Narada to Vyas, he's saying, if you don't make this clear, remember the Bhagavatam reaches its crescendo in the 10th canto and the Panchadaya, those five chapters of the pastimes of Radha and Krishna and the Braja-gopis. And it cannot be dismissed, it must be noted, the nine cantos of prerequisite to reach that point, to not misunderstand what is being expressed there. But nonetheless, that is the point of the Bhagavatam, is to express this and make it clear that there is possibility for this in the upper world, or as Prabhupada mentions, quoting Vishwanath Chakrabarti Thakur, first sloka of the Bhagavatam, janmadyasyataha, etc. The Adi being a reference to Adi Rasa, Madhur Rasa, Mukhya Rasa. Saying Mayavadis, and this is a very interesting point, he's quoting Vishwanath saying that. He said, Mayavadis, because they deny the personality of Godhead, they're inadvertently, indirectly giving impetus for mundane sexuality. You understand? Because they deny the personality of Godhead. So that means this relationship isn't possible in anywhere but here. And like the Grand Inquisitor told Jesus and Dostoevsky, where he said, and besides you and a few of your saint friends, who can, control their senses? Come on. You and a few saints. But, the regular people, they can't do that. Like someone's father of one Chinese girl, we're talking about Buddhism, and said, but my daughter is not Buddha. And I said, maybe she's a little Buddha. She's got a little Buddha. Some Buddha-like qualities. So, this possibility, this prospect, muktir hitvanyata rupam swaropena vibhastiti. It's really thrilling and exciting and astonishing and unbelievable. What if we understand what's being inferred? But it can only be addressed in an inference sort of way. I told Nisringa Chaitanya Prabhu found that sloka in the 11th canto, basically saying that, subtlety to infer is the more favored way of expressing higher truth because of its, in this case, we'll say of its likelihood of being misunderstood, misread. So, the Bhakti Siddhanta Charja, Sanatana Goswami Prabhu. A charge of Sambandha Gyan. Sometimes it can be expressed in different ways, Sambandha relationship, but sometimes Prabhupada would just say, it means knowing what is what. Right? Knowing what is what. And who is who, and who is whom. So his deity, the deity of Sambandha Gyan, Madan Mohan, and must be. And we think, we heard this story, that's some favorite with him, and Rupa Goswami's Govinda, and Raghunath Das Giridhari, but Prayojan expressed as Gopinath. But it's not arbitrary. So necessarily, Madan Mohan must come first. And Guru Maharaj explains why. back to this principle, the Cupid principle, right? That so if eros is the driving principle of material existence, then that's what's also keeping everyone bound in material existence. That attraction, just like an orbit, can't you? And what do they call it when you leave the orbit? You know, the gravitational pull of the Earth. It has a name, but I forgot. But anyway, you understand the idea. There's a certain point within a certain range. You're hopeless. You're just like you must remain within that orbit, but only at a certain point can you leave that and say, come within the magnetic gravitational pull of another. So he's saying here, Madan has that sort of gravitational pull of the mundane erotic principle upon everyone and everything in material existence. So Krishna, as Madan Mohan, the one who has the is how beautiful is Krishna? That Cupid's bewildered. Sometimes they show Cupid with the bow and arrow and kind of like happily inflicting, you know, lust upon others. Like they're hit by an arrow of Cupid and then they're totally bewildered. But here, Cupid seeing someone who is so beautiful that Cupid is bewildered and charmed. Right. Why so? As Brahma's Samhita expressed, Kandarpa, that's another name of Cupid, Kandarpa Koti Kamini Vishesha Shobham. Krishna has the attract, is so beautiful, has the magnetic, seductive attraction of 10 million Cupids personified as one. And for those who've experienced one Cupid, we should think, oh my God. Like that's just inconceivable. One, 10, 100, no. 10 million Cupids could appear as one. And why is I told giving 10 million? Because our mind, I mean, we can hardly accommodate that. What to speak of beyond that? It's talking about some sort of infinite beauty and charm and seductive, attracting. That is who is Krishna. The very name Krishna indicates that. Right? Krish. We call it Krishna. Krish, everything being drawn to the center. And na, he's nourishing everyone. Because he is Rasaraj, he's ecstasy personified. So Madan Mohan necessarily must be the first deity. Why? Because Madan Mohan is capable of breaking the stranglehold that Cupid has on the heart of the conditioned souls. Must necessarily be Madan Mohan, because that needs to be broken. And that's Narada to Vyas, really. He's alluding to this sort of possibility, prospect. You have to clearly express it. Right? Other things have been expressed, general spiritual principles, how to live a spiritual life, engage in spiritual practices to come out of the mundane and make progress toward the spiritual. He said, but really, the average person, they're in the name of spiritual culture, they're going to engage in practices that more or less keep them bound here, that do not break this stranglehold. Right? And that's why he told, it must be you, Vyas, because if anyone were to challenge them, they would say, well, we're following the advice of Veda Vyas. Are you a greater authority than Veda Vyas? No, I don't think so. So Narada is saying, so it has to come from you because you gave everything else, so you have to give this. And your magnum opus, your masterpiece, Purana, Super Purana, Srimad Bhagavatam. There, because and we'll say, well, I mean, Krishna, there was Mahabharata and Krishna there, but in a different capacity, not this Gopi Janabalava. And I say that specifically because that is mentioned there, but only in, how do you say, practically encrypted in the statement of Draupadi upon her disrobing, where we're told, as they're trying to disrobe her, she's trying to, with her own ability, strength, save her modesty, and then she starts crying out to the Lord, and with one, and she's crying. Then we're told, at last, she gives up on her side. Right, what she can do to save her own honor, and she, with both arms raised in the air, completely at the mercy of Krishna, she vibrates saying, hey, you know, hey, Gopi Jana Balava. And it's when she mentions that, Gopi Jana Balava, that means the lovers of the gopis, means that Krishna. Then Krishna starts supplying infinite sari, infinite cloth to her sari. And it's mentioned somewhere else, just for the sake of Leela and pastimes and Puranic legend, that when she was, when as a girl, Krishna cut himself once and she immediately tore her sari and made a band-aid for Krishna from her sari. So she tore a little bit off and fixed Krishna. Then, like, what is that? We give something to Krishna from the heart. Krishna, he only knows infinite reciprocation. He's the infinite. A drop of the infinite is infinite. What to speak of a whole lot of infinite? So when she says, and that everything with Krishna is like that, the cliffhanger, always pressing whatever the first level of resistance or defense strategy is, more drama from Krishna to press that the devotee to go deeper and deeper until they reach the deepest region of their heart where, what is expressed there? Self-forget, not just self-sacrifice, self-forgetfulness to the extreme, where they give up all ego and conception of self in favor of Krishna. And then Krishna gives everything to them. So Madan Mohan has that capacity to break the stranglehold that Cupid has upon the heart. Bidite hridaya granti chidyante sarva sankshaya chiyante chasya karmani mayi drishte akilatmani. Then the devotee is saying, actually, Krishna, you are the object of my heart, what I'm searching for. I've been thinking it's some person, place, thing of this world. I see you are that. Shrutva gunan bhuvana sundara sanvatam te nirvisha karna vivarai haratonga tapam rupam disham dushimitam akilartalabam twaya chuta bhishati chitram apatrapam me. Rukmini. So he's saying, now I've heard about you, Srutva guna, and your qualities, Srutva guna, bhuvana sundar. Understand, you're the most beautiful thing in the world, beyond the beauty of anything here. What is it mentioned in the Bhagavatam elsewhere? Bhushana bhushanangam. He's the ornament's ornament. Sometimes we see that principle here, or regularly, like when they want to sell something to someone, particularly clothes, jewelry, etc. What do you know? They put that on a beautiful model. Right? They don't put it on an ugly person. Not that there's anyone who's ugly, but just for speaking. Right, they don't go, look, here is an ugly person, we put this on them, and now they're, no. They put it on the most beautiful person they can find, and then they look. And then people think, so then if I put that, I'll also be like that. Very nice. Amazing how transformative it can be. But here we're told, Krishna, what's the origin of that? Back to Nimai Pandit saying, no, every word, every concept, you can go back to Krishna. Krishna is the original. Bhushana, Bhushan means ornament. Bhushanangam. He's the ornament's ornament. He, whatever you put on Krishna looks beautiful. Same thing from Mahaprabhu, Nimai Pandit, as we told. When he's playing with the dirty pots, remember, he's golden. He's Gauranga, Gaurahari. When he's playing with those dirty pots, we've seen them in India. You know, in Puri, they still do that, cook in the pot. The pot you get the prasadam in is the pot it was cooked in. They don't cook in one pot and transfer it to another pot. That pot that it's cooked in, you see the black soot on it, that's the pot. So he's got that black soot all over him. But he's Gaurahari, Gauranga, Mahaprabhu. So what is Vrindavan Das Thakur? When Sachi looks at him, she sees Indranila means a blue sapphire, an Indranila gem. Means like the king of sapphires is the Indranila, the blue sapphire. So that's what he looks like when he's dirty from the blackness. When they add that to his Gaurahari, Gauranga complexion, he looks like a shining blue sapphire. That's what she, and who is that? Nilamani, Krishna. So it's a little difficult for her to chastise him, but she does have Vatsalya Bhav, so she's doing the best she can, which is the best ever done. So she can chastise him still. But in the presence of so much beauty, it's overwhelming. So Bhushana Bhushanangam Bhuvana Sundara Srinvatam Te. He's saying, and now I realize why there's such a thing as hearing and why we have ears. Not that an option is hearing about Krishna. She's saying, no, now I understand the idea behind all of this. Hearing, seeing. Right, we have evolutionary biologists saying, no, see, the reason the ears are on the side and then the predators are coming, and, you know, like, please. Like, how can you say that with a straight face? You know, like, really, the hopefully our prospects are higher than that. Set your sights higher. Bhuvana Sundara, the most beautiful thing in the world, and hearing about you, I understand why there's such a thing as hearing. It's a very dramatic, emphatic statement. Nirvishakarna vivarai haratonga tapam. And the end result of this, haratapa, all the suffering, which really is on account of forgetfulness of Krishna, that's gone. Now I'm in touch with you, who are so beautiful and pleasing and Rupam drisham drishimatam akilarta labam. And from this sound, Brahma, comes the Rup Brahma, the form. Krishna comes out of the sound of Krishna. That's why one of the offenses is to not believe that or not conceive that properly. Out of the sound comes the form of Krishna. And he's saying, and now I feel like I've got everything. Yam labha chapram labham manite nadikam tataha. And I understand why there's such, why we can see, what seeing is meant for, what seeing is all about. To hear the most beautiful thing, to see the most beautiful, to serve the most beautiful. Bhajaniya sarvasar guna vishishta. Twayachyuta vishati chitram apatrapam me. Achyuta. Krishna, and she's saying, and now, I say, inextricably surrounded by karmic circumstance, as it appears I am inviting you to kidnap me. So normally, when there's a kidnapping, the ransom note is sent from the kidnappers. But here, Rukmini, it's the opposite. She's writing the kidnapping note. So we can't have any stereotype about what to expect in Krishna conception. Yes. Sure.
Just a second, Maharaj.
Yeah.
Well, in a supreme abode, the main characters of the parshats of Krishna Lilas, do they have a freedom of will? Or they, everything is happening there by the divine will of Krishna?
I just respond as what comes to my mind. Once a beloved disciple of Srila Swami Maharaj was on a walk with him in Central Park, and he said to Prabhupada, he's a very like simple-hearted devotee, he said to Prabhupada. You know, Prabhupada's walking along and he says, does Hare Krishna, he says, Dandavat. He said, does Mother Yasoda really enjoy her pastimes with Krishna? He said this like very sincerely and earnestly. Does Mother Yasoda really enjoy her pastimes with Krishna? And Prabhupada just sort of stopped like, looked at him and disbelief, but almost, you know, to say like, I think what was unsaid bears repeating. If I can say that, and apparently I just did. What was unsaid bears repeating. And that is how to properly conceive of that world. So Guru Maharaj put it this way, I think, once, nicely, when he said, people are always talking about whether or not the jivas have free will. But Guru Maharaj said, and because Krishna's omniscient and he knows everything, like what's going to happen and all. But Guru Maharaj said, does Krishna have free will then? Or is he like, he would be paralyzed. That would be horrible if that's what having, you know, being omniscient entailed, that you have, you just know everything is going to happen. But I think we find hints in the pastimes of Mahaprabhu, where when he's traveling, we know at first there's like 100,000 people following him. They're crying. They're digging up the ground where the tears of Mahaprabhu fall. They're following him as he's trying to go toward Vrindavan. And then a devotee who's part of the, like the ministry of the king or the local Nawab, he knows that Mahaprabhu conceivably could run into some problem with government agents. So he meets with him and saying like, it might be good to take your, you know, and go because I anticipate some obstacles. And there's this one line in there, but it's very interesting, where Mahaprabhu is telling him, he's saying, I will give some inspiration into the heart. As I said, it's a no-op, some governor like that. But he won't interfere with his free will. He said, I'm going to give some inspiration to him. And I'm paraphrasing now, but he says basically, and if he doesn't accept it, I have a B plan. You understand? Like, but, and I thought, oh, this is really insightful. He's saying in advance, I'm going to give some inspiration to him. But it'll be up to him whether he accepts that or not. Should he not accept it, then I'll go in another way. And if we want our minds to explode, you know, we can go, well, but doesn't he know that I... And then Guru Maharaj will just say, then that would be to eliminate the free will of Krishna if he knows everything. If that's what being omniscient means. But I think the beauty here is that who is omniscient, an omnipotent, and every other omni, right? This is astonishing. He's extending to us free will. You can choose to go this way or that way, to give your heart or to withhold your heart, to participate in these pastimes as a contributing agent. Like we see the devotees, as they evolve and enter the necessary plane, they're capable of expressing something new that will actually give joy to Krishna and his devotees. Like, I mean, I think of Guru Maharaj and Gurudev particularly, but saying original things. As Guru Maharaj told me, I say, my God will say, you say things that weren't said by the predecessor acharyas. Then he goes, what? And he said, but we accept them because it's in line with what they say. And sometimes I give this example. I just mentioned, Kandarpa Koti Kamaniya Vishesha Shobham. That's Brahma, Brahma Sangita, about the beauty, seductive charm, sweetness of Krishna. Right? And then some erotic potential is alluded to there. Right? It's Brahma Sangita. Brahma. Guru Maharaj in the Prima Dhamma Stotram, now onto Mahaprabhu, you have Rupa Goswami saying about the beauty of Mahaprabhu, because we were thinking, how can you improve on reality the beautiful? But in Charitamrita, we hear Krishna, we're talking, he's ecstatic, he's beautiful, there's no room for more. He's and saying, yet it increases, and increases with loving exchange with his devotees. That's how. Saying, although there's no room for increase, but in loving exchange with Radharani, Braja-gopis, Nanda, Yasoda, etc., it's increasing, increasingly loving, affectionate, beautiful, etc. So when we think about Krishna, so many things come to mind, but then if we think, Radharani, as we told the other day, Krishna saying, all right, everyone's mad for me, my fragrance is what, you know, when you smell beautiful flowers and wonderful things, and it's, you know, aromatherapy, and it's changing your, you know, he's saying, that's like, you know, a peripheral representation of my fragrance. If you can trace that to the center. So he's saying, everyone's mad by me, but he's saying, but who could inspire me in the way that I'm inspiring everyone? He said, someone who is more qualified than me. These are his own words. And he's saying, and we don't find anyone who's more qualified than me than Radharani. she's more qualified. She, and then he gives the same, as people appreciate him, his aroma, the sound of his flute, he's appreciating her aroma, the sound of her voice, her touch, all the different senses. He's saying, drive me mad. Krishna, that is a shocking revelation from the central conception of the infinite and praise of Srimati Radharani. So then that's astonishing. But then, if we say, what if you combined them? It's almost, well, that's too much. You mean you could combine Radha and Krishna as one? That's too much to conceive. That is Mahaprabhu. Why the devotees, the real followers of Radharani and Krishna are devotees of Mahaprabhu. Because it's Radha and Krishna combined. That's inconceivable. So then the beauty of Radha and Krishna combined, what would that be like? So Rupa Goswami saying, what did he say? Raso dama kamar budhama duradama julatanur jati namu tangshas tarani koti vidyoti basana hiranyanam lakshmi varanabhi angika rucha satchetana kame punarabhi dashor yashati pradam. So he's saying, raso dama kama arbuda. Here's 10 million cupids again. And I'm saying, I'm repurposing the word cupidity in a sense, meaning like cupidness, because it has another meaning actually. But I want to use that, give it a repurpose. So, 10 million cupids in full blown cupidity, madura damodra, I'm saying that's the sort of sweetness and beauty in the tanu, madurojwa, you know, the radiant tanu of Sri Chaitanya Dev, and goes on from there. So this is original from Rupa Goswami. Rupa Goswami is giving this. Right? Guru Maharaj, why did Babaji Maharaj say he liked so much Guru Maharaj's songs, slokas, etc.? He said, we find they're, he's saying, equal to Rupa Goswami, like that. And he's the Rupa Nugadara. We can say that. Guru Maharaj won't say that, but Gurudev will say that. So, what does Guru Maharaj say? Koti kami murchi tangri rupa rasa rangaram prema dama deva meva nomi gora sundaram svarna koti darpanava deho varna gauravam padma pari jata banda ganda bandi tanga sauravam. And talking about fragrance, all these things. But he's saying here, how beautiful is Mahaprabhu? As Rupa Goswami told him, 10 million cupids, that sort of radiant sweetness and full-blown cupidity. Guru Maharaj is saying, 10 million cupids will faint to see the beauty of Mahaprabhu. That's another way of expressing it. And it's original. So what are they saying? You say things that were not said by the predecessor of charges, but we accept them because it is in line with what they express. And what does it point to? This is totally, completely original from the heart of Srila Guru Maharaj. Such devotees are qualified to participate fully in these pastimes and contribute something new and fresh, as inconceivable as it may be. And it gives delight to Radha and Krishna and their to hear this. It will make them all who are, there's no room for expansion, they'll be even more happy and beautiful hearing such things. Hare Krishna.